Hi, my name is Felix and I'm currently a master student at the Leibniz Institute of Photonic Technology in Jena in Germany, and today I want to present you DeconvOptim.jl, and especially I want to talk about microscopy image deconvolution. So first of all, what's image convolution? So usually if you have a blurry image if you want to model blurry images, we use convolutions of images with a blurring kernel. So for example, on the right hand side you can see the isotropic blur of an image, and the blurring kernel is essential to describe the blur. So in optics or in microscopy we call the blurring kernel the point spread function, because it says how a point in the object is mapped onto a blurry point in the image. Then in image processing, people also often use the Gaussian function or Gaussian blurring kernel, but you could also imagine a cigar-shaped object to model some kind of motion blur. And yeah, let's go to the convolution theorem. The convolution theorem is basically states that a convolution in real space can be also expressed via a Fourier transform of the sample, Fourier transform of the point spread function, and then a pointwise multiplication, and then a final inverse Fourier transform. And the advantage of this is that it is very fast, so you can evaluate the Fourier transform in 2D or in 3D very quickly, and especially for large kernels in 3D, this approach is usually faster than the sliding kernels you might know from deep learning, for example. We also know that, or we also call the Fourier transform of the point spread function the OTF, so the optical transfer functions, because it provides some insights into the forward of insights into convolutions. So usually optical system, they act as low pass filter. So if you look at the plot of the OTF here, so that's the Fourier transform of the PSF, you see that there is a certain frequency threshold. So above that frequency threshold, you don't see any information anymore, so the system basically blocks all the high frequencies, and below the frequency threshold we can see that the contrast of these frequency is dampened. So, and by image deconvolution we basically want to bring back these frequencies to a higher contrast. So now we can look at the frequency spectrum of a blurred sample. So the orange one is the ground truth, and now we have to multiply the OTF to the orange one, and therefore you see that it goes down, and around the frequency threshold you see that all information is lost. So basically the information which is still there is just within such a frequency range. Okay, so how does our deconvolution pipeline work? First of all, we use several packages like CygoJL for the automatic differentiation. We're using OptimJL, so for the optimization. We also use Tulio to calculate the regularizers very quickly, and we also can use CUDA to calculate everything on the GPU. So how does our pipeline work? So first of all, we start with an initial guess, and the initial guess is usually a 2D or a 3 data set then, and every pixel or every entry in this array is a variable we want to optimize for. So this is an optimization problem with many million parameters. And then we have some kind of mapping functions. So for example, usually images, they have non-negative values, so therefore we can introduce some constraints into the system. And then we do the forward model, which is usually then the convolution with the point spread function. And then we compare that to our measurement, because the measurement is what we have and we want to optimize something which fits to the measurements. And the loss function, of course, can be changed to a Gaussian function if you have Gaussian noise, or it can change to a Poissonian loss function if you have Poisson noise. And this is a scalar value. And on the second part is the regularizer. So the regularizer also introduced some constraints into the image, like smoothness, or it should preserve some edges. And then we can weight that regularizer, and this gives again a scalar value. And we now want to minimize this scalar value. And for the minimization, we're using typically the LBFGS algorithm provided by OptimJL. And for the gradient step, so we want to calculate the gradients, we use the automatic differentiation. In that case, we're using Cygote for the reverse mode automatic differentiation. What's notably is that for the regularizers, for example, we use here Tulio, so that's a total variation regularizer, and Tulio really allows to write down all the regularizers very easy. And here you can see the total variation is basically the difference between two neighboring pixels. So first in the first dimension, then also in the second dimension, then we take the up square, and finally we take the square root of it. And yeah, the advantage of Tulio is that it is really fast, so usually a factor of 5 to 10 times faster in comparison if you write down everything by hand in a for loop, for example. And especially the backward path is really fast because it basically derives the right-hand side gradient analytically, and then it registers the adjoint for it. So yeah, especially the backward path is really fast using Tulio. Unfortunately, Tulio doesn't really work with n-dimensional data, so it's really restricted to the data you have. So you really have to write it down like this, and therefore we use Julia's metaprogramming. So if the user wants to have a 3D total variation regularizer, we really generate the expression on the fly for that. We can also change that to 40, and then you see we have four different indices and all the expressions. So yeah, this is cool. This is just possible because of Julia's metaprogramming, that we can generate the expressions on the fly and can use them later. Now let's have a look at a few results. So here we can see on the right hand side the deconvolved image, and yeah, already after a few iterations the image looks quite good. And down here you can see the frequency content, so the green one is the deconvolved image. And however, if we deconvolve too much, we can see that we can bring, or that we can increase the higher frequencies, but we also see that the image looks very unnatural. The reason is that we basically only amplify noise, and therefore then we should turn on the regularizer. And then if we also increase the lambda, you can see that we basically can regularize the image so it looks better. And yeah, we also can change the regularizers to total variation, then we maybe should decrease the weight. And yeah, you can see really the image appearance depends a lot on the regularizers, and you should adapt both the lambda and the regularizers to your need and especially also your problem. Yeah, we can also look at real microscopy data. So on the right hand side you see a very blurry and very noisy image. On the left hand side you can see the deconvolved one. And now, for example, you can see here the three fingers and here the two fingers, which were barely visible on the right hand side picture. As a conclusion, we can say that DeconvOptim.jl is a very flexible image deconvolution software. So it works in principle with n-dimensional data. So it works 1D data, it works on images, it works on volumes, it also works on 4D and 5D images. For example, if you have different colors, or if you maybe have a time series, and it also works on both the CPUs and GPUs. And usually if you calculate everything on a GPU, we see typically a speed improvement of a factor of 5 to 15, and of course depending on the hardware. Okay, thanks.